Charlie, say hi.
Hi.
Yeah, hi. Say hi. Out for a walk Saturday afternoon with the little dude, doing some errands, grabbing some groceries so we can make some dinner. And by we, I mean my wife, because I can't cook. And so grew out some ridiculous facial hair in hopes of starting some run good for the new year. It has not worked, let me tell you. Right, Charlie? No, Daddy has not been lucky. Yeah, played a little bit of 3-5 first day of the new year. Got absolutely smoked. Got all in aces versus kings. He flops a king, slow rolls me. Kings versus ace king, queen jack high flop. River 10, turned the nuts with 9-10 on an ace 6-7-8 board. Shoved huge, got called by 10-7 of spades for a chop to a straight and a spade draw. He rivered a chop and then decided to tell me that I'm really lucky. This is right after losing the aces to kings. So that was a lot of fun, right, Charlie? People are ridiculous. Tell them they're ridiculous. Yeah, I know. So, yeah, that was pretty awful. Just couldn't win a hand. Thankfully, the day afterwards, won in PLO, and the day after that again, which was last night, won again in PLO. So I think I'm up a little bit for the new year, over 3 sessions, which is kind of frustrating because if that first session goes decent, I'd actually probably have a good start. Right, buddy? Yeah. Yeah, need some good luck. Maybe if I brought you into the casino like this, I'd run a little better. What do you think? Bah, I know, need some good luck. Hopefully we'll get in some more poker tonight. Turn it all around. What do you think, Charlie? Yeah, gotta say hi to the people. Gotta say hi to the people, man. Bro, if you don't say hi, how are they gonna know who you are? A little camera shy, huh? So all these vloggers keep talking about the vlog run good. I have no idea what that's about because I have yet to make a hand and hold in about like 2 months. So I'm waiting for my vlogging run good. Also, I think I'm getting fat here. Charlie, we're getting fat. You're getting me fat, I gotta keep walking. But yeah, hopefully things turn around in the new year. Like I said, trying to no shave. January? Yeah, gotta create your own style. Turn around the luck. Yes, turn around the luck. Turn around. What are you looking at, buddy? All right, say bye to the people. Say bye to the people. Bye-bye. So after enjoying a nice home-cooked meal, head to the casino, and here's one of the first hands we play. Ooh, is that ace-king suited? So it folds to the cutoff, who opens to 15. The small blind calls 15 as well, and I make it 75 out of the big blind. This is a spot that I don't mind just taking it down preflop. I think I could have sized it to about 65 instead of 75, but everyone's a bunch of monkeys and they have a hard time folding, so I actually don't really mind my sizing too much. As expected, people don't show up to a casino to fold, and the cutoff calls, and we go heads up to a flop, which comes queen, jack, 7 with 1 diamond. I think leading here with 2 overs, the nut gutter, and a backdoor flush draw is fine, and probably the standard play. We can size rather small as well, since I think his range will consist of a lot of smaller pocket pairs, which we expect to fold. Ace, queen, and ace, king, which probably won't fold to 1 bet, no matter the size. And finally, pairs jack, jack, plus, which we don't expect to fold for obvious reasons. I elect to check because I don't expect him to turn under pairs into a bluff, and I feel this board hits his 3-bet calling range pretty hard given the preflop sizing. I also think if he decides to bet, the sizing will give me all the information I need on how to proceed. After I check, he thinks for 30 seconds and bets 140 into the $165 pot. The bet is fairly large given the rainbow texture of the flop. I don't expect him to have sets here given the large sizing. It's possible that he has aces or kings, but considering my preflop 3-bet, you would think he would have to fear my check on a queen jack 7 flop and the likelihood that I might have flopped a set myself.
I think his most likely holding is some one pair hand, ace queen, king queen, perhaps ace jack, some under pairs he's bluffing with, as well as ace king. I think he'll fold most of these if I shove, since it's 280 more and represents more than 50% of his preflop stack. Unfortunately, I think this thought process is a pretty big mistake, especially in smaller games. One of my biggest leaks is that once I sense weakness, I think people have a fold button if they've put some chips in the pot. I end up jamming for 280 more, and he instantly goes into the tank and starts talking about how sick it is and how I have to have pocket jacks. After a bit of a tank, he ends up calling with ace queen. Thankfully, the turn is the perfect 10 of diamonds, giving me the nuts and the backdoor royal draw. The river is a 10, and I scoop. In hindsight, I prefer just leaving the flop for around $60. If he raises, we still leave ourselves the option to shove, and if he flats, we can proceed from there. This is the problem with playing 100 big blind capped games. There just isn't enough room for any maneuvering. A couple of hands later, I'm dealt pocket queens in a straddle pot and open to 35, the button playing a $350 stack flats, and the big blind playing a $300 stack ends up 3-betting to 150. Given that this is a straddle pot, I'm just never folding, so I end up 4-betting to 300. Unfortunately, the button ended up flatting with aces, so he gets it in, and then the big blind tank calls it off with pocket sevens. Worse yet is he ends up hitting a 7 and triples up through the both of us. What hurts the most is if the big blind doesn't decide to get goofy, I probably don't lose too much more in this hand because the flop ended up coming king high. Yes, that's the give and take of no limit hold'em. Sometimes you put the beats on people and other times they put the beats on you. Shortly after the pocket queen's hand, we're able to start a second game of 5-5-10 pot limit Omaha. So I head over from 3-5 no limit, a small winner. Alright, now let's get into the four card fun. Double the cards, triple the excitement? I'd say that's about right. I did the mathematical calculation. Right off the bat, I get dealt ace, king, king, queen with nut diamonds and open to 45. Nearly the entire table calls and we go six way to a flop of 8-7 deuce with two hearts. Given that I don't have any hearts and the board is fairly wet with straight and flush draws, I decide to check. There's just too many opponents in the hand and leading here would be more of a bluff as I can't call any raises and even once called it'll be hard to continue on many turns. At best I would hope someone has a draw and even then kings could be mathematically behind. It ends up checking through and the turn is the ace of clubs, so now there's two clubs. Given that I 3-bet pre and didn't get 4-bet as well as having an ace blocker, this is a great spot to represent top set. The board is very wet now with two possible flush draws and straight draws. I decide to bet 260 into the about $270 pot, and somehow it folds through. I've got to say, that could have been a pretty sick sweat, given that much of the river would have been a scare card. Can't say I can complain. In this hand we get dealt 10-10-4-5 in the cutoff and call a raise. We go four-handed to a flop of King-6-3 rainbow with the 3 of clubs. It checks to me and I decide to pot since I have 3 to a straight flush draw as well as the middle set draw. Alright, I'm just kidding guys. I check it back. In this spot there's really no point in betting the open-ender since I can easily get check raised and I don't really have much of a hand here to call the re-raise with. Not to mention people could have better straight draws, so there's just no reason to bet and get blown off the hand. I'd much rather just check it back and be able to realize my equity with the open-ender. The turn comes the ace of clubs and now I'm open-ended with a small flush draw. In fact, I actually have one out to a straight flush. The player in the small blind, who looked like he had wanted to bet the flop, leads for 100 into the $170 pot. Folding here is fine in my opinion, since it's possible your flush draw is dominated and you have no real showdown value. I called because I'm drawn to the nut straight, have the opportunity to straight flush over nut flush my opponent, and can use my pocket 10s as blockers to bluff a queen or a jack river. It's also possible that if I hit a 10, I can check back the river and win with a set. The river is a deuce of clubs, and now my opponent checks. Wait a second. Did I just make a straight flush? Yeah, let's have a look at those cards again. Yep, straight flush. At this point, it's important to find a bet size that can target his calling range. Given that he's checked the river, it's pretty unlikely that he's made a flush, And so it seems that his most likely hand is going to be some two pair or possible set. I think betting big here could get a call, but I'd much rather bet smaller and give it an opportunity to make a light call or spaz out with a check raise. I felt that this particular opponent might read my bet sizing as weakness, so I decided to bet $120 into the about $370 pot, which is obviously pretty small. Thankfully, he thinks for a bit and puts in a check raise of $380. You can only imagine what my face looked like once that happened. It's at this point that I believe I made my biggest mistake. I ended up re-raising him to about $800, which is a $420 re-raise. His most likely hand here is going to be a complete bluff, or he's going to have the king high flush. And if that's the case, I should be raising much larger since it's pretty unlikely that he's going to fold. Unfortunately for me, he ends up saying, oh, I guess this is a bad time to have the king blocker, and he folds. I get to table my hand and collect a bonus from the casino for a high hand. I also realized after the hand that if he did in fact have the king of clubs, I made a pretty big mistake in my bet size on the river. If I did bet larger, then his check raise would have obviously been much larger as a bluff. So it looks like I made a bet sizing error in two spots. In this last hand that I have video footage of, I get dealt 9-10 jack queen double suited and open for the full pot. We go four-handed to the flop, which comes 6-7-8 rainbow. I decided to lead small with the nuts. I don't really want to get too tricky here. I think if I check and start piling in money later, it'll be really obvious what I have. Unfortunately, everybody folds. So the last hand of note, I unfortunately didn't get any footage of, but I was able to fully discuss on my car ride the next day. So we're gonna cut to that next. Another beautiful day in San Francisco. How's it going, everybody? It's been a minute since I've had a chance to record some stuff. We're on our way right now to take Charlie to his gymboree class. He's got to get some exercise in, you know what I'm saying? Gotta be a active little kid. So, played last night, a bit frustrated with the results. I ended up being, I think at the highest point I was up 1300, playing PLO. Started off in PLO, second game broke, then headed back to 3-5. And then the PLO started up again. So I won a little bit in the first PLO, won a little bit in the 3-5. Jumped back in PLO, was up about 1300 at some point, or 1000, then 500, then back up to 1300. And before I knew it again, I was only up 600, not even sure how. Just ended up, I guess, losing. Just calling pre-flop, some raises, some C-bets, stuff like that, you know, 50, 60 at a time. A couple of hands you don't win, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, where'd hundreds of dollars go? So that happens, and then the one hand I didn't get footage of. So I think somebody opens to 30 early position. There are a bunch of callers. I call out of the blind. I think I'm in the big blind or the small blind with king 10 9 8 double suited. And now this straddler, a friend of mine in my direct left, he pots to a full 190. Everybody folds back to me. I believe in this spot he's gonna have aces most of the time. It's possible obviously that he has a hand like ace, king, queen, jack, double suited, or some sort of like nice rundown. It's possible, but given that I have blockers to the rundowns, I think it's a little less likely. Also, the speed with which he snapped 3-bet to a full pot just led me to believe that he's always got aces. So the fact that I'm double suited with a little bit of a rundown, no aces in my hand, I like my hand. So when it folds around to me, I decided to defend. I think I'm a little more experienced in the game than he is. So I think I might get away with a couple of bluffs in some spots. So I call and I decided to check dark, which I'm not a fan of. But I mean, I know I'm always checking to him anyway, which maybe isn't the best case, because if I end up flopping huge, maybe it's best to just lead into him if I believe he has aces, because it can be pretty hard for him to call. So anyway, so I check dark. The flop comes 8-7 deuce, I believe. So great flop for me. I think I flop
either one or two backdoor flush draws, because I think it was rainbow, as well as open-ended, a pair, and just, I mean, if he does in fact have aces, I'm actually a favorite once I flop a pair open-ended with no ace in my hand. So he checks back, unfortunately. So that kind of sucks. I think if he did see bet, I would have put in a raise, and I think he's gonna find himself in a difficult spot. Maybe he calls it off, because it is rainbow, so it's a little less likely to kind of put me on, you know, a set of eights or a set of sevens or something like that. So he checks back. The turn is a seven. Now I think about leading into him, but I just don't feel like I'm going to get him to fold aces now that he's checked back. I think he's trying to pot control, so I'm not sure he's gonna fold unless maybe he goes bet. So I think for a while, and I decided to check. Also, obviously, I hate the turn because now it kind of counterfeits all my two pair draws. I can no longer hit the 9, the 10, the king if he does, in fact, have aces. So I check, and now he bets 140, which is obviously a really, really small bet given that he pot to 190 and all the 30s in there. I think it's like a third pot bet, maybe even less. Right, Charlie? Yeah, ridiculous. So he bets 140, which I think, again, feels like aces. Feels like he doesn't want to bet too big. Given what he had, it actually makes a lot of sense what he bet. I obviously don't put him on something like flopping two pair or top set or anything like that. Like if he has ace 8-8 or something, I think he's gonna bet the flop. Maybe not, because it is 8-7 deuce rainbow, so maybe he wants to, you know, try to let me hang myself. But still, I feel like he's gonna see bet there, because in PLO you just never really know what your opponent has. Like I have a bunch of straight draws. You don't really want to like flop a set and just check back. I guess in this spot I could just fold if I think he has aces. I don't really have any outs. But again, I think get a little overconfident in my abilities and my nitty image, thinking that I can get people to fold. So I call, and the river's a 4, so 5-6 gets there. And now I decide to turn my hand into a bluff. I think he, you know, isn't really going to be able to call against me if I do make a big bet. I think I am going to have a lot of time straight draws in this, you know, in this hand, which ends up being pretty obvious that I did have 9-10. So I bet 5-20. And he kind of sigh, immediately goes, "Well, I should be snapping you here." Thinks for maybe like 5 seconds, if that, and calls. And he ends up having ace 7-5, I think it was. So he ends up having the 7 blocker on the flop, checks it back, because, you know, obviously he blocks the two pairs in the sets with the 7. And then when he turns trip 7s and I check again to him, he's probably figuring he's way ahead. So he decides to put out a small bet. So pretty unfortunate. End up bluffing off a ton of money there. Get myself stuck with that hand. Play a little bit longer. I think get about unstuck, and then my wife lets me know that Charlie's been crying all night, so I need to come home and help out. So I do that, and end up leaving a small winner for the day, which is pretty frustrating, given that I was up like 1,300. You know, it feels pretty painful to have a bunch of hands, nice hands, be up a bunch, and then give it back slowly. But you know, that is what it is. That's about it. So hopefully the weather's nice. It's been kind of rainy on and off. And yeah, nothing else new. All right, thanks.
All right, say bye to the people, Charlie. Bye to the people.
Peace.